homecoming. Today, the USS Blue Ridge, the command ship of the 7th Fleet, is returning to its home base after 6 months at sea. At first glance, this could be San Diego or Newport News, but in fact, it's the Yokosuka Naval Base in Japan, 50 miles from Tokyo. From 1985 to 1992, the United States spent over $30 billion on Yokosuka and other military bases defending Japan. During the same period, Japanese companies spent more than $100 billion buying American companies and real estate. They bought over $41 billion of America's growing debt. Yokosuka represents an old American vision of power, out of sync with the world outside its gates. For in Tokyo, Osaka, and in the factories of the interior, there is a new vision of power. It is economic power, and it is made in Japan. This is the story of how it came to be. This corporate video reinforces the stereotype of Japan's work culture. 120 million people working in harmony for an economic machine called Japan Inc. But the truth is that the success of Japan Inc. has little to do with culture. Japan Inc. is a three-legged political machine made up of businessmen, politicians, and bureaucrats. It was not born from harmony, but from conflict. In 1960, Japan was a bitterly divided nation with a very uncertain future.
Flares of the lights and shouting, as though it was the eve of a revolution. Never in our history we had that kind of thing before or since.
To understand Japan's economic power is to understand its political system and the deals made to unite a divided nation. In 1960, the party in power was the conservative LDP. It was run by Nobusuke Kishi, a man who had been jailed as a war criminal during the American occupation. Kishi owed his comeback to his pre-war contacts with big business and his skill at backroom deals.
He was the Japanese version of the savvy old Paul, who was very conscious of his high position. The Japanese have that old slogan, Kanson Minpi, revere the bureaucrat and despise the public. Well, that was Kishi all over.
By 1960, the Japanese economy was marching to Kishi's drumbeat. Japanese companies were disciplined, and many took their orders from the government ministries in Tokyo. But as the government pushed the country toward economic growth, there were others who rebelled against the growing central control. In his groundbreaking film, A Cruel Story of Youth, Nagisa Oshima tapped the mood of a new generation who saw in his films their own dreams of liberation.
Thank you. 我々の怒りあるいはまあロジックも含めてね。
We were full of a passionate anger.
日本の古い社会構造あるいはまあ。
We wanted to destroy all vestiges of pre-war Japan, from the family structure right up to the society as a whole.
そういうものが一番基本的にあったと思うんですね。
There was a lot of confusion about where the country was going. The young people thought one thing. They were influenced by democracy as they saw it. The old people were nervous about that. Management went one way. Labor was going another. There were vicious, protracted strikes in Japan's major industries, Toyota and Nissan among them. There was a very active, vocal political left. Everything was building up toward that year of 1960, which became a crisis point. In modern Japanese history.
Fujiyama, Japan's most famous landmark, is the background of a U.S. Marine Corps rocket exercise.
The crisis was touched off by the fear of America's military ambitions. Since 1952, a U.S.-Japan security treaty had scattered U.S. military bases and nuclear weapons throughout Japan. In 1960, when Kishi decided to renew the treaty, socialists and college students erupted in protest. Only 15 years after Hiroshima, they feared Japan could become the battlefield in a nuclear war with the Soviet Union.
The post-war student movement was basically anti-government. As war was still fresh in everyone's memory, it was also a statement that the people wanted to ensure that Japan would never fight another war. Since America had occupied and somewhat rearmed Japan, the demonstrations also inevitably became anti-American.
Kishi and his LDP thought America's Cold War with the Soviet Union would benefit Japan. America would defend and support the Japanese while they focused on building their economy.
During the Cold War, Japan took advantage of and profited from American protection. It allowed for our economic prosperity.
This treaty represents an indestructible partnership between our two countries, in which our relations would be based on complete equality and mutual understanding.
Kishi signed the new security treaty in Washington, then invited Eisenhower to Japan. He promised the treaty would be ratified in time for his arrival. Kishi returned home to massive demonstrations outside the Diet, the Japanese parliament. But Kishi was determined to pass the treaty before Eisenhower's visit. He used his political muscle to cut off debate. In desperation, socialist politicians, outflanked and bypassed by Kishi, tried to stop the treaty process by barricading the Speaker of the House in his office. Kishi sent in police to pull his parliamentary opponents out of the Diet building. Finally, the police were able to push the speaker through the melee to the podium. The LDP seized the opportunity to take a sudden vote on the treaty. It passed overwhelmingly, since there were no socialists in the Diet chamber. Many saw Kishi's autocratic tactics as an attack on democracy. Students vented their anger on James Haggerty, the advance man for Eisenhower's visit. Five days later, students launched a full-scale siege on the Japanese government itself.
I joined demonstration because of the Kishi attitude toward Japanese people. He really tried to force it in very undemocratic way. And that's another scare, because we just started learning democracy. We are very happy. We wanted to make it more matured. But he's the one who decided to again sort of turn it down.
In the year's most violent riot, a young student was killed. Eisenhower canceled his visit. Kishi resigned in embarrassment just 5 days after the treaty was ratified.
In Japanese politics, one politician resigns, you wipe the slate clean. But the Liberal Democrats were still very much in power. The American alliance, as they saw it, had been cemented. That was behind them. They were now trying to look toward the future.
First pillar of Japan Inc. was in place, a conservative political party allied with America and devoted to economic growth. By 1960, some Japanese began to glimpse prosperity. In Tokyo department stores, elegant fashion shows drew curious crowds. They couldn't afford the clothes, but they could dream of a time when they could.
She cries and tries to sing a song. Boy, canary will sing.
The collision between dreams of affluence and memories of poverty raised difficult questions. Where was Japan heading, and who would be left behind? In 1960, while protests raged in Tokyo, the eyes of the nation were drawn to a few poverty-torn villages on the island of Kyushu. In a collection of photographs by Ken Domon called The Children of Chikuho, Japanese caught a glimpse of life in the coal towns. Here, by the mountains of chalky black bricks that had fueled the nation, miners would erupt in Japan's most violent battle over the rights of workers and the future of the Japanese economy. For over a century, coal had been Japan's most important natural resource. But the miners were anything but national heroes.
Miners were desperate people. They were called scamps or rogues. I was 17 when I first started working in the mines. When I came home, I wouldn't tell anyone that I was a miner. Of course, the money was better than many jobs in the area, but it was miserable work.
From the hard life of the coal mines grew powerful labor unions. The most militant local emerged from the Miike mine of the Mitsui Company. Fearing layoffs in a nation with few good jobs, the miners had negotiated ironclad guarantees of job security. But changes were on the horizon. By 1960, the United States had guaranteed Japan's access to a new source of energy, oil. The Japanese government decided to steer the country away from coal. In response to the new energy policy, Mitsui broke its agreement with the miners and laid off 1,200 workers. Outraged workers occupied the mine. It was the beginning of a bitter strike at Miike that would last nearly 10 months. The struggle began when Mitsui sponsored a new union with foremen, managers, and replacement workers. Then Mitsui tried to send them past the picket lines to work the mines.
Thank you.
struggle at Miike captured national attention. Many of the same activists who were battling the security treaty in Tokyo traveled to Miike to help the strikers. The miners' strategy was to keep the company from shipping its coal. Mitsui's strategy was to outlast the miners. They had financial support from many of Japan's major industrial companies who were determined to break the unions any way they could.
One day, 12 hired cars pulled up. Out stepped a group of hired thugs. They made sure we saw that they had knives and guns. Then they asked for the leader of the picket line. The workers were getting scared, so I got them singing labor songs. The thugs left. But about 2 minutes later, a worker from the south gate roared up on his motorcycle. He was screaming, "Kubo-san has been stabbed." By the time I got there, all I saw was my friend Kubo-san being carried off to the hospital. Even today, when I hear the word Mitsui, my heart swells with hatred. Back then, everyone, husbands and wives, children and adults, felt the same way. It was that hatred that sustained us throughout the fight.
By July of 1960, Miike was a national crisis. The Japanese government sent 15,000 members of the National Police Force, 10% of the country's total, to force the union away from the mine. Sympathetic Japanese unions responded by sending in over 15,000 workers. The government was nervous about a possible bloodbath. 10 months after the strike had begun, the government persuaded Mitsui and the Miike Union to accept binding arbitration. The Central Labor Relations Board ruled in favor of Mitsui. The miners lost their strike at Miike, but their ability to wage such a long battle left its mark on Japan. Seeing the bitterness of workers as a threat to the future, Japan's largest companies made one crucial concession to workers.
The unions won an end to arbitrary layoffs. Management did all it could to prevent layoffs in order to have a more satisfied workforce. Gradually, Japan's major industries adopted a policy of so-called lifetime employment.
Job security bought labor peace and stability for Japan's largest companies, the second pillar of Japan, Inc. But to move forward, the government needed to unify the Japanese people. That was hard, for old political wounds still divided the nation. In angry speeches made during the election campaign of November 1960, the leader of the socialists, Eneijiro Asanuma, warned that the specter of pre-war Japan still haunted the nation. His vision was tragically real.
Thank you.
Asanuma died moments later. His assassination by a right-wing fanatic stunned the nation. It was a terrifying climax to a year filled with bitter conflict. As 1960 ended, the battle-weary Japanese looked for someone to heal the wounds of the nation. The man who emerged was not a man of business or a man of politics. He came from the most critical division of Japan, Inc., the economic bureaucracy. His name was Hayato Ikeda.
He was a bureaucrat rather than a politician. He came out of the finance ministry. He dealt with practical problems and practical solutions. No wonder when he came to France that de Gaulle, after meeting him, was so unimpressed and said, "Who was that transistor salesman?" Well, de Gaulle didn't realize it, but that's exactly what Ikeda was. He came to sell transistors. He came to preside over the transformation of the Japanese economy.
Ikeda set a simple goal for everyone: double your income. It was a catchy phrase that became a kind of sunny national anthem. They called it Akarui Sekatsu, a bright new life. As Japanese industry churned out new products and kept people working, consumers bought their way to a new prosperity. There were three items every family had to have: the three treasures, a refrigerator, a washing machine, and a TV set. As Japan grew, many Americans assumed that the Japanese economy was dancing to an American beat.
Viewed from the outside, Japan looked like an imitation of the U.S. But in point of fact, Japan was evolving toward a very, very different economic and political pattern. The name of the game was capitalism, but Japan and the United States were playing by a very, very different set of rules.
No one knows the rules of the game better than Takeshi Isayama. For decades, men like Isayama have guided the Japanese economy on behalf of MITI, the Ministry of International Trade and Industry. At this corporate baseball tournament, Isayama is the guest of honor, a sign of a special reverence for government bureaucrats not found in America. In the United States, the government is like an umpire, making sure business plays by the rules. But in Japan, the government is on the field, coaching industry. Big business and government are on the same team.
People in Japan expect certain things of the Japanese government, of the central bureaucracy. Actually, there's quite a high expectation that they will be defending the national interest. And I think in the post-war period, that has been defined primarily as promoting Japan's economic development.
Like most Japanese bureaucrats, Isayama's crowded bullpen office does not reflect the prestige of his position. He heads the division of MITI that oversees the global development of Japan's latest high technology. Day after day, Isayama hears about the problems facing Japanese corporations. Then he writes the laws that govern industry. Isayama also offers special incentives to help companies develop new technology.
Miti's job is to guide the development of Japan's future. If a certain segment of industry wants to go one way, and another wants to go another way, the conflict will be destructive. It is Miti's job to mediate and choose the best road for all.
Today, the businessmen who come to see Isayama are wealthy and powerful. He must use the gentle art of persuasion to advance Miti's goals. But 30 years ago, Miti was the commander-in-chief of the Japanese economy. It gave the orders, and companies obeyed.
Japan was a developing nation, and in order to catch up to the other nations economically, it was necessary for some degree of protection, financial support, and regulations. These were the primary responsibilities of Miti.
Miti funneled Japan's scarce resources to key industries. In 1957, Miti decided Japan's future depended on electronics.
Radio. Radio wa makoto ni kindai bunka no seika tomo iu beki desho.
Miti favored Japan's big pre-war companies like Toshiba, Hitachi, and Matsushita. Little companies had a harder time. In the 1950s, Akio Morita helped to found a small tape recorder company that would become Sony. He wanted to buy a new American invention called the transistor, but he needed permission from Miti.
When we applied Miti, our government, did not think Sony has appropriate engineering power. So they delayed their approval. So it took more than 6 months to get the final approval to send the money.
When Miti gave permission, Sony bought the transistor license for $25,000. A year later, Sony produced the first transistor radios made in Japan.
Sing, 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 everybody start to sing. La-di-da, hoody-hood, how you singing with us when? Sing, 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 sing.
Through private initiative and government guidance, the Japanese electronics industry grew at a furious pace.
The music halls are loud, everybody calls the town. It's something you should know. Oh, oh, baby, oh, yes, sing, sing.
But high-speed growth put Japan on a collision course with the United States and an American institution, television.
Well, it means... Excuse me. It means that you see virtually everything the TV camera sees and transmits. There's more picture.
Television was an American invention. In 1955, there were 27 U.S. TV producers with familiar names like RCA, General Electric, and Zenith. Now there's only one. In 1955, there were 10 Japanese TV companies.
Sony! Sony! Sony!
Today, all 10 are still in business. The The story of TV is the story of the collision of two economic systems. In the U.S., American companies were on their own. In Japan, companies often worked together and were protected and guided by the government.
Here's a man in evening clothes.
Miti encouraged Japanese companies to buy American TV technology from GE and RCA. The U.S. proudly sold its technology to keep Japan strong against the communist threat. And the U.S. looked the other way as the Japanese government protected Japan from U.S. competition.
The government's great priority was maintaining a smooth diplomatic and military relationship with Japan, having free access to the bases in Japan, and really great reluctance in the State Department, the White House, the National Security Council, the Pentagon, for the U.S. to do anything that might upset that nice, smooth relationship.
While their home market was protected, Japanese companies captivated American consumers with snazzy new products. Their quality was high, and their price was low. That was good news for American consumers, and bad news for U.S. TV makers. But despite intense competition from Japan, American companies kept doing things the same old way.
The American electronics industry is a classic example of economic short-sightedness. They went for the style and better service instead of technological innovation. When they wanted to cut costs, they'd farm out the production offshore to factories in Mexico or somewhere in the third world. Fundamentally, they were contemptuous of Japanese competition, and of course, they paid for that contempt dearly.
Call RCA Factory Service. There's a branch in most cities and you can depend on RCA Factory Service.
While U.S. companies sold service, Japanese manufacturers were working on sets that didn't need it. In 1966, Miti supervised a research project aimed at replacing tubes with transistors. Every Japanese TV company was involved. 3 years later, the Japanese introduced the world to the next generation of color TV. While Japanese companies openly cooperated on research, many secretly conspired to keep prices high at home while undercutting prices in the United States.
They had an arrangement in the U.S. market in which the Japanese companies agreed that they would not attack each other in the U.S. market. They would attack Motorola or Zenith or General Electric by quoting very low prices to the distributors of those companies' products, but they would not go after each other in the U.S. market.
That's life.
That's life.
That's what people say.
By the mid-1970s, American consumers were hooked on inexpensive, well-made Japanese TVs, and the U.S. television industry was mortally wounded.
I said that's life.
We in the United States focus upon the consumer as the ultimate objective of economic policy. The Japanese really focus upon the needs of the producer and more generally they look upon production of key products and industries as being the basis of national security. Far from fearing concentrations of power, they promote them.
In the beginning, Akio Morita and Sony were outsiders in the Japanese system. Today, Morita is the chairman of Japan's National Industry Group, and Sony is the fifth largest Japanese electronics company.
This is a new product. So I like this product very much. So
this is the new CD-ROM player, which can hold an entire encyclopedia. Sony's strength comes from its ability to invent new products.
To this end, the Japanese government allows Sony and other companies to form keiretsu, groupings of banks, manufacturers, and distributors that would be illegal under antitrust laws in the U.S.
One of the differences, I think, between the U.S. and Japanese governments, certainly, and to some extent the industry, is that the Japanese side does look at an industry in a very integrated way and in a long-term perspective. And so for them, I think consumer electronics certainly was important for its own sake of producing transistor radios and color TVs. But more importantly, in the long term, they have seen the consumer electronics industry all along as a building block.
From electronics, Japan moved into computers and the chips that run them, semiconductors. In head-to-head competition with American firms, the Japanese outdid Americans on price and quality. To U.S. trade negotiator Clyde Prestowitz, the financial power of the Japanese system made all the difference.
During the height of the semiconductor problem, I met with the head of one of Japan's semiconductor companies. And I asked him, I said, like, I'm amazed. I know that you're making over $500 million in losses this year. I know that. And he said, yes, that's right. And I said, you've just announced you're going to expand your capacity by 40%. How do you do that? He said, our group, not our company, our group, his company is in the Mitsui Group, thinks that semiconductors are fundamental to many of their businesses. And so we're going to stay in this regardless. Now, that man is a talented manager, no doubt about it. But I've known him for a long time. I don't think he's better than many American managers. But he lives in an environment in which his capital is free.
Japan can offer cheap capital to industry because of high savings rates, close ties between banks and corporations, and government intervention in the stock market. It's a critical advantage over the United States. In 1989, Sony bought Columbia Pictures, a major American film producer. To help finance the takeover, Sony borrowed $2.8 billion, much of it at less than 1% interest. The game had changed. Flush with cash, Japanese companies went on a buying spree in America, acquiring large chunks of Los Angeles and New York. Purchases that provoked a very hostile reaction.
Rockefeller Center with the Radio City Music Hall has been a mecca for American tourists. Now we don't own it. Will the Rockettes become geishas?
Frankly, I was shocked seeing such a reaction because I didn't expect such a thing to happen. Because I knew some other movie company were both of Australian and some other nationalities. So I thought, why not Japanese?
But resentment in America had been building for some time as Americans realized that their closest ally in the Pacific had become their fiercest economic competitor. Today, despite the fact that over 500,000 Americans work for Japanese companies, some businessmen and politicians are blaming U.S. economic problems on the Japanese system. In 1992, President Bush traveled to Tokyo as a salesman for American auto parts, in a trip that only served to reinforce images of Japan's economic power. Fear of Japan is not confined to the U.S. In Thailand, this anti-Japanese rock video evokes old memories of Japan's wartime expansion. But it portrays Japan today, a hungry economic machine that's gobbling up its neighbors and the world. Since 1987, Japan has invested $27 billion in Southeast Asia. In Thailand, currently 117 Japanese companies have major operations.
In Singapore, the Japanese employ nearly one-third of the workforce.
Nani o?
But many Southeast Asians fear that this Japanese investment may not be in their best interest.
Sayonara.
We do know that Americans promote Singaporean staff faster than Japanese. We know that European companies promote Singaporean staff also faster than Japanese. The Japanese, for some reason, do not believe that the Singaporean is learning as fast as the Americans or the Europeans believe. So if you go around Singapore today, at least a dozen American companies, you name them, IBM, Hewlett-Packard, their CEOs here are all Singaporean. I can't name one Japanese company where the CEO is a Singaporean.
Japan Inc. was built to deliver the goods to the Japanese, but exporting this economic machine meant reckoning with its power and its global responsibilities. The Japanese government says it has a global mission, investing overseas to assist developing countries.
ODA, を今世界の中で一番...
Who is contributing the largest amount of money to the Overseas Development Assistance Fund? Japan is. Look at the third world debt, especially in Mexico, Brazil, and Argentina. Here again, it is Japan putting in the most money.
But in Japan's case, we only give away money. Of course, there is some technological aid, but basically, we just pay for the right to be part of the global community. We Japanese lack, some say we are incapable of, the human aspects of internationalization. We are not culturally open. All the world sees us as is this cold, economically oriented country and does not see the Japanese as people.
To outsiders, Japan Inc. seems united. In fact, it is a web of deals between squabbling special interests. At the center of this web is an unlikely political power, rice farmers. Their clout is a relic of an older Japan, increasingly at odds with the modern world. Koichi Kato is one of the most powerful politicians in Japan. Today, he's the honored guest at a school in his rural home district. In a few years, these young women from Japan's rice belt will vote, so they are important to Kato's future. But they are also a link to an older Japan, which is at the heart of the Japanese political system. There is nostalgia in Japan for village life, with its values of harmony and cooperation. Rice is considered a national treasure, a symbol of the self-sufficiency of an island nation. Kato and his LDP play to these mythic values and have turned them into a political reality. Japan's voting system is based on geography, not population. So in some districts, the vote of a farmer can be four times more powerful than the vote of a city dweller. To stay in power, Kato's LDP has been very good to Japan's farmers. Thanks to Kato, these farmers have newly stabilized riverbanks, a $3 million rice husking center, and a new airport.
稼働講演会の初会合であります。まず皆さんの健康を祝しながら稼働先生のますますの発展を常にして乾杯を申し上げます。乾杯。
For decades, the LDP has kept small farmers happy by supporting a ban on foreign rice. As a result, Japanese rice costs roughly 6 times more than the world price. But today, the LDP is in a bind. Japan's closest ally, the U.S., wants Japan to open up its economic system and admit American rice. Farmers refuse to let one grain of American rice enter Japan. Rice is a symbol of the bigger challenge facing the LDP, balancing old local politics with new global economics.
We often tell the Japanese public that an economic giant like Japan must act more responsibly toward the global community. Nevertheless, we are still winning in local elections.
The party still wins local elections because of the power of its old-fashioned political machine. Here, Kato throws the muscle of his party behind Hiroshi Misawa, an LDP politician running for local office. Misawa couldn't ask for a better helping hand. By managing old myths and economic progress, the LDP has brought Japan remarkable stability. But the deals made to stay in power have handcuffed the party to special interests and led to Japan Inc.'s biggest problem, money politics. The enormous wealth of Japanese corporations has seduced the LDP into peddling more and more of its influence.
Money is the cement in this unholy alliance between Japanese big business and the ruling Liberal Democratic Party. In Japan, you need a lot because you're fighting not just the opposition politicians, you're fighting other factions within your party, and you're beholden to an awful lot of people. That's why otherwise respectable politicians will do appalling things.
Corruption reached new heights when in 1989 an influence peddling scandal involving Japan's recruit corporation implicated nearly every top LDP politician.
People have nowhere to turn but to the LDP. Recently, we were faced with such highly emotional issues as a recruit scandal. It was as if the LDP was caught in a rain shower. Now the shower is over, the sun is out, and our body is dry.
But in 1991, another shower struck Japan. The scandal took place here at Nomura Securities. Nomura and three other brokerage firms confessed to giving more than $1.5 billion in rebates to corporate clients who lost money in the stock market.
It turned out that the Ministry of Finance had known about the practice for years. But the ministry did nothing because of Nomura's key role as a fundraiser for Japanese companies. The scandal proved that Japan's system can promote business, but cannot regulate it. Yuriko Hase is a member of Japan's Social Democratic Party, the group that claims to oppose everything the ruling party represents.
I entered the race as a representative of everyday people. I have been working for human rights and am very concerned about education and pollution. As a woman politician, I'm also working very hard to promote equality between men and women.
Far from the rice country of the LDP, this is Hase's stomping ground, the urban streets of Tokyo. Here, voters are receptive to Hase's message that LDP policies have consciously favored corporations at the expense of working men and women.
Since the war, the government, economy, and society in general have put all their energies into production. Now things are too expensive, and people don't understand why. Well, one reason is that the Japanese are too meek and just accept things as inevitable. We don't fight back, and we don't speak our feelings.
Hase's message is strong, but her party is weak. Without access to corporate funding, some democratic socialists take secret handouts from the same sources as the ruling party, which props up the opposition in order to control dissent. Late in 1991, the outspoken Hase learned the price of dissent. She was rebuked for breaking a rule against wearing hats in the parliament. Hase refused to remove her berets, which had become her personal signature. But instead of supporting her, her own party pressured her to back down for the sake of harmony. The beret episode was a minor incident, but it recalled an old Japanese saying, "The nail that sticks up will be hammered down." Today, protests outside the political system are the most serious sign of dissent. These marchers are protesting a government plan to dam up Japan's last whitewater river. Among many Japanese, there is growing fear that their quality of life is being sacrificed for the relentless drive toward economic growth.
Why are we working so hard? People are beginning to question their mission in life. They feel like fools for working themselves to the point of exhaustion. We are just beginning to realize that we are, in fact, economic animals.
This wasteland in the middle of Tokyo Bay is called Gomi no Shima, Garbage Island. It is the final resting place for products that cannot be sold, and it is a symbol of an economic machine that cannot stop itself.
The problem is that the unfortunately machine itself keeps moving for the same purposes. And it's so strong and so established, and it's very hard to sort of destroy the machine and create a new machine for in order to achieve the new target. That's the problem at the moment. And everybody knows we are going to the totally wrong direction, and but we don't know how to stop it.
Thirty years ago, Japan was a nation in turmoil. It chose then to leave its defense to the U.S. and to solve its domestic problems by building the most efficient economic machine in the world. Today, the Cold War is over, and Japan is an economic superpower. But with financial might comes political responsibility. Japan must emerge from the shadow of the United States and find a purpose for its newfound power. Today, Japan reckons with how to reinvent itself one more time.
Major funding for this program was provided by the Annenberg CPB Project and the Ford Foundation.